Good morning, welcome. My name is Sohail Iskandari, as he already told you. And I'm going to talk about partial reverse engineering of AMFS. That's my thesis, which I have done at Fox IT. It was commissioned by Fox IT. And the content of this presentation is as follows. I'm first of all going to talk about the introduction. After that, I'll talk about the research goals, research method, results, and the conclusion. Introduction is divided in two parts, virtual machine file system, that's the VMFS, and the problem of the research. The introduction. VMware is a virtualization company, and they have made the basic of a dynamic infrastructure, which is called ESX. ESX uses VMFS as a file system for storage, and the benefits of VMFS are that it makes it possible to have a maximum volume size of 64 terabytes. You can have 2048 hosts that can access the file system at the same time, and the file system has the ability to expand the volume on the fly, which is also called the dynamic growth. And you also have the sub block of 8 kilobytes. The problem of this research was as follows. Companies need guarantee of the availability from the data, and if that's of great importance, and if that's not guaranteed, they have problems. And corruption of file systems is a kind of troubles that you can face with the file systems. And the other problem is that the VMFS is a proprietary file system, and there are not many publicly available documents about the technical aspect of the file system. At this moment, investigators or people can reconstruct data by using by searching for headers and footers of files, but that's not going to work always, because if you have a sparse file or fragmentation, you get in trouble. What is sparse file? Sparse files is as follows. If you have a file with zeroed values, then a file system is going to split the file, it's going to cut the zeroed values, it is going to register the zeroed values, and it's going to merge the non-zero values, and he writes it on the physical drive. So what is written on the physical drive is actually this and not that one. And if at the end, if you export this file by looking for the headers and the footers, your file will be corrupted. And that's not what you want. Fragmentation is like this. If the file system has not enough space to save a file in sequence, it is going to split the file and write it away in across the file system. As an example, we have file C. The file system hadn't enough space to write it in sequence, so it split it in two parts, and he write it away. He saved it across the file system. In this case, also, if you export file C, you will get a corrupted file, what is not nice. The research of these goals are this. I try to use reverse engineering for to achieve these goals, and the first goal was to achieve a description of VMFS structure, and also to determine the allocation of data in VMFS. So how is VMFS? How does VMFS work? How does VMFS allocate the file blocks, the data blocks? And also obtaining metadata information, and at the end, we wanted to reconstruct data, but this one is not succeeded completely, because we cannot yet use reconstruction, but we have interesting information about VMFS what we didn't have before. The research method is this is a figure of the research method. First of all, you start with a literature study, and after that I try to create data sets Beside the data set, I also had the registration documents. In the next slide, I'm going to talk about the registration documents. And after the creation of the data set, I made a comparison on bit level. I tried to look at different data sets to see the differences. What are the differences to and what kind of recurring patterns did I see, did I face? I tried to figure out what the recurring patterns means, to make a conclusion, and if that was happen, I try to verify it and validate and so on. If that was not happened and I needed more information, I tried to search more information and to get what I needed. The registration documents contain information such as creation time, block size, partition size, and the modification regarding to each file I added or deleted in the file system, and also the version of the VMFS itself or other parts. And these are actually examples of the information which I registered in those documents. The results of this investigation, there are actually two parts, the MBR, master boot record, and the GPT. Those are standard. Also the logical volume manager, that one is also a standard. But I have divided it in two parts, MBR and GPT, and the VMFS. VMFS consists of LVM, heartbeat, system files, resources, clusters, and cluster groups. In the next slide, I'm going to tell you what those things mean. First of all, I have a figure, I have an illustration, where you can see where every part I have mentioned is located in a VMFS disk. First of all, we have MBR, GPT, OVM, and if you're talking about GPT, we have also a GPT backup. And that's a copy of that one. If that one is corrupted or we lost the information in it, we can always get this one back over there and we have our information back. We have also cluster groups with resources and all of that. But I'm going to explain this in the following slide. Master boot record is at the beginning of every disk. In master boot record, you have information about you have the description, you have the boot code, you also have the partition entries. For each partition entry, you have those information, you can register such information, but only the partition type, the starting logical block address, and the size in sectors were interesting for me, because I don't need the other ones. Those ones you need only if you are looking at the file system on the physical level. But that was not interesting for my research. Now, in master boot record, you can only have four entries. In this example, we only have one entry. And I'm going to show you what kind of information I can export from there. The first one is that the partition is not bootable. The second one is that the following partition, the first partition after this, is an EFI GPT disk. That's a GPT disk. And it starts in sector one, and it is so many sectors big. After that, we have the GPT. In GPT contains information about the partitions that are following, which are in GPT itself. And the first information you can find in GPT is the logical block address of the backup header, and you have a globally unique identifier of GPT, and the third one is the logical block address of the beginning of the GPT partition table, which is the number two. That means that the first partition table in GPT starts in sector two of the disk. And for every partition entry, there is 128 bytes reserved. The first partition, it has the type. This means that this partition is a VMFS partition. And this is the unique partition gate. And the sector where it begins is 2048. And that partition is so many sectors big. After that, we have the logical volume manager in VMFS. Logical volume manager makes it possible, for example, of course, to expand VMFS volumes on the fly. And it is in total 1 megabyte big. It has this header, and you can see in the red selection over there the version of the VMFS which is following. Actually, the VMFS itself begins from the volume header, because this explains the this is the volume header of the VMFS itself, and it's the signature. And after that, we have an identifier, or actually, it is the universally unique identifier of VMFS, which is which contains four parts. The first part is the machine time at the creation of the VMFS partition. The second one is a CPU timestamp counter in Little Endian, of course. And the third one is just a random number. It doesn't matter what it is. And the last one is the MAC address of the service console. But the first one is interesting for me. And that is the machine time at the creation of the VMFS. You can figure out when the VMFS volume is created. So if you take this number and you turn it, you convert it to a human-readable number, you will get this this number, and you can convert that one to because this one is a epoch time, and you can convert it to a human-readable time and date and time, and you will get the time when the partition is created. The volume header, that's the same as the previous slide. It also contains the version of the, actually the block size of the VMFS. You can find it here in the blue selection. This is the value, and if you convert it to decimal from hexadecimal to decimal, you will get this value, and that means that this part, that this VMFS partition has a block size of 1 megabyte. After the volume header, we get the heartbeat of VMFS. The heartbeat starts 1 megabyte after the volume header in that sector. It the VMFS registers the availability of all ESX hosts that are using the partition, the VMFS partition, in the heartbeat. The heartbeat is 2048 sectors big. That means that it's enough for 2048 hosts that can access the VMFS, and it has this signature. I also have information about the structure of the heartbeat, how it is ordered. So sometimes people can get problems with the structure. So it gets corrupted, and if you know the structure, you can modify it, and you can fix your problem. You can fix the corruption. VMFS uses 5 system files, and those system files are actually meant to arrange the allocation around the file system, in the file system. The properties of those files is that that they start with a dot, they have the extension .sf, and they grow in size if you have a smaller block size. That means if you have a file what you try to save, and the file is 4 megabyte, and you have a block size of 2 megabyte, and you try to write it, you have 2 references to data blocks to write it away. And if you use a block size of 1 megabyte, you will need 4 references, because you will need 4 data blocks of 1 megabyte to save the data. Now, that means that the registration that you will need grows. You will need more space to save the information that you need. That's exactly what here stands. And the growth is not significant, because that will not happen a lot. And the system files contain metadata, and it is not possible to remove the system files. What does a system files do? The system files manage actually the five resources in VMFS. VMFS works with five resources. The first one is a fault descriptor. A fault descriptor contains information about the fault itself, about the references of the fault where it is saved, references to the data blocks. And a fault descriptor can also sometimes contain the content of the fault itself. But the fault has to be smaller than 1 kilobyte. If the fault is smaller than 1 kilobyte, it can be saved in the fault descriptor itself. But is the fault not smaller than 1 kilobyte, then the fault system is going to use fault blocks or subblocks. Fault blocks are 1 megabyte big, and subblocks are 8 kilobyte. They are actually, VMFS has subblocks to, in order to, has subblocks in order to, sorry, has subblocks in order to use the available space efficiently. There are also pointer blocks and additional blocks, additional pointer blocks. I'm going to explain this in the next slide. We have additional pointer. If the fault descriptor has not enough space to save the references to the data blocks, it is going to use a pointer block. But if the pointer block also has not enough space, then it is going to use an additional pointer block, and an additional pointer block makes it possible to save more references to data blocks or resources. These are the names of the system files. And we have resources. Resources are in groups, which is called a resource cluster. Resource clusters are also in groups, and that is called cluster groups. At the beginning of a cluster group, we have information about the fault locking and also about the metadata. Well, VMFS has five system files. All of those system files contain an allocation register. The allocation register starts 128 sectors after the beginning of the file, and it has the next structure. You see at the beginning of the allocation this value. It means that this allocation register can register 198 resources, or they are allocated or not. And here it says that there are so many available. And this one says there are so many in use. That means that here we have not used any resources yet. And if you count this, if you take the sum of this, you will get the same number as we have here and here. In this case, I have added two files in the file system, and I see that that something changed. That is the first pair of double F. This one is changed to FC, from FF to FC. That means that there are two resources in use at this moment, and you can see that over there, that the number is, the value is changed to C4. C4 is equal to 196. Before it was 198, and you can see over there that there are two resources in use. After that, I have deleted the files, and I saw that this value got back to FF. That means that if you add a file, the file system will change the allocation, and the resource itself, the content of the resource, which is actually also the content of your file, will not be modified. It will be the same. It will stay unchanged. And that's exactly the conclusion of this research. With the removal of a file, the allocation register will be modified, but the content of the resource where the file is saved will stay unchanged. And that means, as long as it is not overwritten, that means that data reconstruction is possible. But during my research, I couldn't find the reference between the allocation register and the resources. The reference between those I am missing, and that's the reason why I cannot reconstruct data yet. Recommendation of this research is as follow: you have to figure out how those resources are referenced to the allocation register. and how many resources does a cluster contain, and where does a cluster group, a resource cluster, or a resource begin. That was my presentation. And are there any questions? Sorry?
I just found Googling that there's
the VMFS driver, you mean?
In Java.
Yes, of course. It works. It works only for VMFS version 3, and this what I have in this research, I have figured out the structure of VMFS version 5.
Okay,
so that's a difference. Question. Yes.
Any other questions? No more questions? Okay, well, thank you very much.
All right.